My father, Mr. Kesh Narayan, would have been 98 today. As many of you may know, he passed away a little over 4 years ago, leaving the world as he had lived in it, happy, content, and full of goodwill for everyone. If there was one thing that singled Father out, it was his enormous capacity for friendships. As someone aptly mentioned, he had a degree in people. What gave him the most happiness was the company of friends, which was an ever-expanding tribe. We therefore thought a good way to remember him was to get many of his friends and well-wishers together and organize talks by eminent personalities from different fields. We began the KS in Oration series last year with a talk by David Gower, the English Test cricket captain. And of course, this year we are fortunate to have with us two outstanding exponents of economic and political thought, Deepak Parekh and Shekhar Gupta. Deepak Parekh is chairman of the HDFC Group, an institution that he has been associated with for 40 years. I will not go into a detailed introduction. We have left a little flyer for you, and I'm sure it's not required because most of you know him. But just to give you an overview, till the 60s, a housing loan was something that you got only from the LIC. Conceptualizing a publicly held housing finance company model, setting it up and building it over the 40 years to the diversified financial behemoth it is today stands clear testimony to Deepak's abilities. His accomplishments and achievements are many, and as I said, I will not get into a detailed recounting. He is always in demand by government and other authorities when there are difficult situations to handle. In fact, I was half expecting to be put on the BCCI's list of administrators, but I guess he's over 70, right? Unless he got disqualified. A clear thinker with firm ideas on policy reform in various sectors, he has at different times been mentioned as a possible governor of the Reserve Bank and even a possible finance minister. He is the first port of call for international investors seeking practical guidance and has chaired many MNC boards in India. But over and above all this and his many achievements, the one thing that stands out clearly about Deepak is that he is an anachronism in today's financial world. He is a banker with a heart. The number of industrialists and businessmen he has helped out of a tight financial corner is legend. His lending policies are dictated by a strong touch of practicality and willingness to assist. And even more than the businesses being lent to are based on an assessment of the people behind them. At all times, of course, keeping the interests of HDFC at heart. On a personal level, I'm particularly glad that Deepak is with us today, since the relationship between our families spans three generations. His uncle, the late H.T. Parekh, chairman of ICICI, who I believe was instrumental in Deepak's return to India and in the establishment of HDFC, was a good personal friend of my father. Those days, on almost every visit to Madras, as it was then known, he would be at home for a meal of rice and curds and a game of rummy with my parents. Deepak, of course, has been a good friend of mine for many years, and of late has become a great source of advice and mentorship to my son, Vijay. From the third generation, Deepak's sons, Aditya and Siddharth, who are establishing themselves independently as financial entrepreneurs in their own right, are good friends of Vijay. This decade-long multi-generational relationship makes it particularly apt that he's delivering the oration today. Deepak, thank you so much for being with us. The other doyen on the dais today, Shekhar Gupta, is, I'm sure, equally well known to the audience. After a long and very successful career as editor-in-chief of the Indian Express Group, he's now chairman of the print. He puts out the highly influential column, National Interest. He has become a well-recognized and popular TV personality with his shows Off the Cuff and Walk the Talk. I personally am an addict to his Walk the Talk interviews with personalities from every sector of Indian life, politics, industry, sports, entertainment, and what have you. His style of putting the most difficult and incisive questions in a highly disarming and friendly tone makes for extremely watchable programs. Again, on a personal level, what I am particularly impressed with is Shekhar's memory. And I will give you one example. When I called him to invite him for today's event, and I had met him only once before, he immediately recalled that he had met me at a social function 10 years ago. Now, what is special about this feat of memory was on that particular occasion, both of us were paying rather more attention to a power couple also present. Given that half of this couple was the well-known model and actress Padma Lakshmi, and the lesser half, her husband at the time, Salman Rushdie, the fact that Shekhar not only noticed me, but also remembered me is amazing. For a person of such achievements, he's a disarming personality, so charming and easy to get on with, that his interviews, the people he interviews, are immediately put at ease. Shekhar, incidentally, I'm told about your personality by at least more than one lady in the audience that your oomph factor on the small screen is very high. Now, I don't know what that factor means, but it's obviously something pretty good.
Factor on? Oomph. On what?
When Shekhar asked me how I felt the oration would be conducted, I suggested that it would probably be a good idea to replicate his walk the talk style, except that he and Deepak would not be ambulating, but would be sitting comfortably. Given these two gentlemen's enormous store of knowledge and experience of matters economic and political, and their intimate familiarity with both the issues and the actors on the Indian stage, ladies and gentlemen, I'm sure we are in for a very entertaining and enlightening session. Deepak Parekh will first address this, followed by Shekhar Gupta. Thereafter, they will interact in a question and answer mode on different topics. And then they have both agreed to subsequently respond to questions from the audience, of which I hope there will be many.
I'm delighted to be here at the K.S. Narayanan Oration. We are gathered here to honor and celebrate the illustrious life and contributions of Mr. K.S. Narayanan, who will always be remembered. He was known to his friends as Nara. As one of South India's most revered business leaders, as a visionary who sought technologies from faraway lands like Scandinavia, brought it to India to make in India in those days. As a man who followed his heart and his passions. But above all, he'll always be remembered as a man of principles, a man of integrity, and a man who always kept his word. The world, unfortunately, has very few such men today. As Shankar said, I recall my uncle, H.T. Parekh, would meet KSN every time he came to Chennai. They never talked business, but they never talked about work, but they only enjoyed a game of rummy with no stakes. And I was saying it's such a waste of time playing rummy for 2-3 hours with no stakes at all. But they never had any stakes, even small stakes they would not play. KSN had a happy disposition towards life. Let me tell you, very few people are like that. I distinctly recall reading a quote of his where he has said he was happy with his business, he was happy with his family, and he was therefore happy in life. And he would like to live up to 100 years. Unfortunately, he didn't make it to a century, but needless to say, he left an indelible mark in the history of Indian industrialists. If one looks at the life and work of KSN in today's context, one recognizes that he was certainly a man ahead of his times. One of his most important traits of being a leader is the ability to stay on course and look at the future with optimism. Leaders need to believe that they have the ability to shape the future and to shape a better future. This is exactly what KSN did through his 5 decades of being a businessman. It was always his optimism that kept him going. Early in his life, he displayed his inherent entrepreneurial zest. I suppose that is what got him out of banking into his first venture of printing ink factory, And from those humble beginnings, he went from strength to strength as he expanded and diversified his businesses. But at the end of the day, business is business. Great leaders are rarely remembered for the number of businesses they start, the number of businesses they create, the wealth they generate for themselves, or the profits they make for their companies. But leaders are remembered for the impact they make on other people's lives. Individuals are remembered not for what they've achieved during their careers, but the goodwill they earned during their career. Today, businesses are expected to be socially responsive and be responsible corporate citizens. Yet, unfortunately, for many corporates, CSR is a rule to be followed as an obligation to be fulfilled. But true philanthropists play it differently, and KSN was one of them. He always showed genuine concern and compassion for the less fortunate. So does Shankar, and so does Vijay. The innumerable number of lives he touched through his charitable trusts and foundations in the fields of healthcare, education was commendable. Another remarkable aspect of KSN wasn't the type that he got bogged down by the stress of running a business. In the current times, we talk about the importance of work-life balance. KSN embodied this philosophy throughout his life. He pursued his business interests and his hobbies with the same enthusiasm and the same passion. His love for cricket and tennis was well known. But his ability to spot talent and put in time, effort, and resources to motivate the talent he spotted, what made him different. It may be the fashion of our time now to own a cricket team or be associated with the sports league, but KSN again was way ahead of his time with his team Jolly Rovers. I understand the team is over 50 years old and it's still going strong with Shankar holding the reins now. It has been my pleasure interacting with Shankar and Kumar and working with the Sanmar group over the last many years. In the more recent period, I've been particularly impressed with the way Vijay has taken on the responsibilities. Chip of the old block, Vijay, as they say. Through the four family generations, all the businesses in the Sanmar group are professionally managed. Across all its stakeholders, be it bankers, customers, collaborators, investors, or partners, they will vouch for the integrity of the Sanmar group. Businesses that are built to last are those that value their reputation more than anything else. So thank you, Shankar, for having me here today.
I've been ambushed into doing this. I wasn't asked. I wasn't warned that I have to speak. But it's like, I don't know how many of you see Hindi movies, but I'm sure all movies have been like that through the years. In the 60s, when we had really sad Hindi movies with Meena Kumari, Dilip Kumar, and it got a bit too serious, suddenly in the middle, a comedian like Johnny Walker would come in, apropos of nothing, and do a little jig so tension levels will come down a little bit. So I think that's the role I've been asked to play. So after Deepak's made a serious speech, I've been asked to say a couple of things. So I don't have to very much to say. You know, since you mentioned about memory, you remember things by association. So Deepak, beginning of a new year, as you sit in your high ivory tower in Bombay, in your high new ivory tower in Bombay, give us a sort of a Sanjay's view of the state of the world. Adharm kshetre, whatever kshetre.
So let me begin by saying that the world has become much more complex today. The global growth will increase compared to last year. But the global growth amongst all the countries in the world will be about 3.4% compared to 3.1% last year. So it's a very slow growth. And the increase or the growth is largely due to the US economy is expected to do much better. And therefore, the global growth looks a little higher in 2017.
Now, if you see the U.S. has become a conundrum. The new, the radically different political leadership style is riding on populism, is riding on anti-globalization, is riding on protectionism and insularity. And this is what the president-elect, I mean, the now the President Trump, is pushing for. Now we'll have to wait and see whether the political rhetoric will be translated into policies and actions. But the first week experience I see, I don't feel very comfortable because he started doing things while which he had promised during his election campaign. He's trying to make US more insular. He's trying to look more inward. The US economy is looking up because he's promised lower taxes. He's promised a huge infrastructure spend of $1 trillion. He's promised pro-growth policies, lesser regulations, and everything, more jobs to be created, more factories to be brought back to the United States. So it's creating a lot of euphoria. The euphoria is such that after he got elected in November, the Dow Jones index went up all-time high. And it's reached 20,000. It's never reached 20,000. Now it's 20,000. Not only the US index, but even the global stock markets are at a 19-month high. And we've not seen the results yet. But despite that, the euphoria is there. Now, there are some people, there's an opposite view, Shekhar, that a large country, a large developed economy like United States have independent, strong institutions with checks and balances that will avoid, that will prevent the president to take too adverse or too irrational decisions. Let us see what he does. But if you look at the other side, if US is trying to get out of the global space, China is waiting. China is desperate to get into the shoes of United States and play a more global role. But China would like to push globalization. China would like to push free trade. China would like to push a forward movement in climate change. Exactly opposite of what we are expecting from United States. So we cannot ignore China. China's growth, China's prosperity over the last few years has really grown significantly, as on a number of areas you can see. The Chinese currency has been accepted by the IMF as a reserve currency. You know, they have a very large, ambitious project, One Belt, One Road, which links Asia, Europe, and Africa by road and rail. Then China has been host to G20, APEC meetings. Even in South China Sea, the military prowess of China is increasing. So China is waiting to take this role. Now, if I compare India and China, I think we are always at unease dealing with China. It's always been tricky dealing with China. Hindi chini bhai bhai doesn't hold good anymore, which was the slogan in the Nehru days. So if you look at some numbers, our exports to China have been falling. Last year, our exports were $10 billion to China. We imported from China $61 billion last year. $61 billion. So China has already become our largest trading partner. Now the difficulty with China is that they do not bother about commercial enterprises. They do not bother about viability of a company. And this is a global issue that they are known to dump their products, as they have been dumping everything and anything into India. Therefore, the imports have been so high at below cost. A case in point is India's steel industry. For 1 year, 1.5 years, the steel industry was bleeding in India because of imports, cheap imports from China, much cheaper than the domestic cost of steel. Until the Prime Minister's office put a minimum import price, it was after that, about 8 months, 10 months ago, that Indian steel industries had started recovering and showing some viability, and the installed capacity, higher installed capacity production is happening. So aluminum is another area where again I hear that government is thinking of bringing a minimum import price. So we have to be very careful about our industry, because our industry is only operating at 70%. And if industry doesn't operate at 80-90%, private expenditure will not happen. New factories will not be built. And just to conclude this, Shekhar, for one more minute, we've seen what's happened in Europe. We've seen Brexit. Now Brexit, you have to go to, they'll have to go to Parliament to get a vote. Later on this year, Germany, France, and Netherlands are going to polls, and the populist parties are gaining ground. We don't know who is the next exit in EU after UK, which other country will exit EU. So even the European area is a little shaky at the moment. And the biggest concern I have in this is that as US interest rates go up, which they are going to go, it will have a huge ramification on our currency. Because money that was coming in for United States for the last 5 years will start going out in large numbers. And volatility of our currency, not only our other emerging economies also, and emerging economies will have to guard against this outflow, massive outflow of debt, which we have taken. So that is the reason I said that the world is much more complex today than it was.
So the problem with Trump is not only that he's making these radical changes to America, but he's making them all on Twitter. So I don't think he bothers very much about institutions. I think he fires first and then checks out the consequences. You talked about global markets being at an all-time high. That's not the case with India. Usually Indian markets follow global trends and usually do better than them. But this time Indian markets are laggards. In fact, if you bought the Sensex in 2008, you are still, if you account for inflation, you are still deep underwater. You are dead. You've lost almost 35-40% of your value. Is there going to be any redemption for India, particularly given this environment in the world?
No, I don't look at it that negatively, Shekhar. If you take the year 2016, January to 31st December, Indian markets have only appreciated by 2%, much lower than most countries. Brazil has gone 40%, Russia has gone 30%, Indonesia has gone 30%.
Depreciated.
Appreciated. The markets have appreciated. Well, Indian markets have remained more or less static. That is because our Indian markets are dominated by foreign institutional inflows. Foreign institutional inflows have been slow this year and in fact have been negative in the last 3 months. But the silver lining I see is that the Indian public have started investing in mutual funds. The amount of money mutual funds are getting in the last 3 months have been incredibly large. After demonetization, every month, the 2 months that have gone by, more than 10,000 crores have come to all mutual funds in equity schemes, not debt, equity schemes. So I'm hopeful we are also getting a fair amount of money in our mutual fund these days. So the mutual fund growth is good, and we cannot be permanently dependent on foreign flows and foreign institutions. We have to develop our own markets. We have to develop our own savings. We have to increase the insurance investments into the equity market. India has the most rigorous rules of investing in equity. If you see international insurance companies, they put bulk of their money in equity. Here we have to put bulk of our money in government securities, state government securities, debt, bank deposits, and a small portion in equity. So if these rules change, because insurance is also a nascent industry, it's a sunrise industry, because we have now too many players, more players. So I'm quite hopeful that we have to stand on our own feet, don't depend on foreign money for our markets to go up, and try and mobilize, catalyze savings of individuals.
Why has foreign money gone away? Is it just because of global factors, or is it because foreign investors are losing faith in India?
Foreign investors are feeling the US market is better than India. That is the reason. And currency volatility will be there.
And that's what they worry about.
That's what they worry about.
So you said more money is coming into equities now.
In India, from Indians.
From Indians. Since this is predominantly a business gathering, we can explore this a bit more. Is that one of the positive effects of demonetization, that people have this money in the bank, they've collected from everywhere and put this in the bank, they have to park it someplace, and banks are offering too little interest?
I don't think it's because of demonetization. I think genuinely people feel that as bank interest rates come down in any economy, any time, you see more inflow in equities. If interest rates come down further, there will be more inflow in equity, because people don't not wanting to invest 6% and 7% on a per annum basis on interest. So it's a question of what is your interest rate in the economy. That depends on flow, inflow and outflow of domestic money into mutual fund or bank deposits.
So this is just about the markets in India. But what about India's economy? What does India have to do in this global scenario to get its economy out of the doldrums? Doldrums are when you have no real movement, when your winds are not blowing, so you're stuck. It's very boring.
Again, I feel that the government has done a lot recently, and demonetization is something that is a short-term pain that we are going through. And we see business coming back. January is better than December. So far as loans are concerned, so far as business proposals are concerned. And I'm sure in the next couple of months, 2 to 3 months, things will be back to normal. Once Reserve Bank relaxes the withdrawal limit of 24,000 a week also, you will see more consumption spend. But so far as growth engines are concerned, there are 4 avenues of growth engines. One is government expenditure. One is private consumption. One is private spending. Capital spending, and 4th is exports. 2 out of the 4 are not working in our favor at the moment. Exports have been perennially slow the whole year. Barring December, there was a marginal increase in export. For 11 months, our exports are down month on month. So exports are not growing. Private spending is not happening. Private spending in new factories and all, because I mentioned about capacity utilization and surplus capacity in the system in practically every industry. So the 2 factors are government spending, and government has done a lot in the last 2 years. Many public sector companies have announced massive programs. Apart from public sector companies like NTPC and BHEL and others, but even government organizations like railways. Railways have taken up a huge expansion program, which will create more jobs, which will create more employment and growth and prosperity. So government expenditure is happening. Private consumption was happening until November 8th. Private consumption has slowed down. And I'm quite confident that private consumption will come back. May not be the type of luxury goods or anything, but discretionary spending may not be there. But private spending will start. So out of the 4 engines, 2 were never working in our favor. Having said that, if you look at our numbers, our reserves are all-time high, $360 billion. Our fiscal deficit is going to be 3.5% of GDP, which is a very acceptable number. Our current account deficit is going to be less than 1%. Our foreign debt is about $460 billion, which is nothing compared to a large country like India. Other smaller economies have larger debt, international debt than we have. So all macro numbers are very positive. CPI, the inflation numbers have come down. Interest rates are coming down. Government has passed the bankruptcy code. GST is round the corner. So there's fair amount of things happening. What we need is we need growth. We need some dynamism in the states. The growth happens in the states. And I must say, I was very disappointed, Shankar, to see that when we were growing up 20 years ago, Tamil Nadu was the number one state for ease of doing business. The latest number I saw, we've come to number 18. Tamil Nadu is number 18.
40 years ago, not 20 years ago.
No, 20, 30 years ago. 30 years ago, when we were in college, or 40 years ago. But Gujarat, that was number 1, has now become number 5. And Andhra Pradesh and Telangana have overtaken. Jharkhand and Uttarakhand has overtaken Gujarat. Maharashtra is number 8. What we need to do is there is competition between states. And some of these smaller states, they have got the right attitude of ease of doing business. One more thing can be done, apart from ease of doing business. I think the government should also have index of health, education, and nutrition in these states and see which state has the best healthcare program for the underprivileged, or education standards, or nutrition. Because these are very critical for long-term growth in India. like ease of doing business index, we should have an index about these, because that will help the states to improve. You know, there is competition between states. It's very good what is happening. So I'm quite positive that it's not that India has done that badly, or we are still, even at 7.1%, which is the revised GDP expectation, we are still one of the largest or the largest large economic growth.
Well, Deepak, I'll put a flag of caution there, because it's on a very low base. You know, the problem with us Indians is we declare victory too soon. It's not a line I spoke, it's a line Vishwanathan Anand spoke on a Walk the Talk a long time back, where I said, India is doing so well, etc. And he said, the problem with us is we declare victory too soon. So, in fact, Xi Jinping reminded us at Davos just a couple of weeks back. He said, we may be growing at 6.6% this year, which is lower by our standards, but at 6.6%, I am adding multiples of wealth to what China did when it was growing in double digits. So the scales are very different. And I frankly, I don't buy these growth figures. You might. I don't think you do, because they fixed them 2 years back. And if you do that, then we were growing at double digits for many years. So I think that's complicated. But the basic question of demonetization. Was it a good thing to do, bad thing to do? There are good side, there are good effects and bad effects, but net, was this much of a shock necessary?
Well, the objective of demonetization was very laudable, and it had a number of objectives. Now, whether we succeeded or not, it's anyone's guess. The objective was to increase the tax base. The objective was to use less cash in the economy. Russia and India have the largest amount of cash utilization in the economy. How to reduce counterfeit? How to reduce counterfeit notes? Move faster to digitization? Bring better governance and transparency to electoral funding? These were some of the reasons why demonetization.
If I may interrupt you, it's like, you know, if somebody is refusing to lose weight, right, which is a lot of people, you send them to ICU and put them on the drip and prevent them from eating anything for 3 months. Make it 50 days and then drag it by another 50 days. This is, I'm sorry to say so, but nonsensical. I mean, I'm never off the record and I'm never no comment. So, you know, I'm a journalist.
No, I think, demonetization is a done deal. What we have to move forward is the impact on it. How can the impact be shortest period of time and we move on ahead? September, October were the best months I have seen in Indian economy. November, it slowed down because of demonetization. But the objective was to take, let me say also that demonetization was one plan. It was a big plan, one item in the plan. If you see this government's policies, it came out with, it amended the tax treaties with Mauritius, Cyprus, and Singapore. It got into an agreement with OECD and countries that they would reveal any Indians having accounts in their countries. They came up with the income declaration scheme. Before that, they had a black money scheme for Indians having money abroad to come and declare. So it's not an isolated item. It's not over yet, because the amount of money that was expected would not come back. There more may have come back than what was anticipated by the government. So now they'll go after Benami transaction. Now they may go after bank lockers. It's not over. You can easily.
But do you worry about precisely that? If Income Tax Department and CBI and Indian police could ensure cleanliness in public life, we would never be corrupt.
I agree. We don't want to come under income tax clutches ever, because you can't get out of it then. But, you know, the sad part is.
And frankly, they led zeros to everything, like our former CAG, I'm sorry.
No, let me tell you the sad part of our country. There are 3.7 crores people who filed income tax return last year, which is 3% of our population. It includes youngsters and all, so it's a higher number. Out of which, 5.5 lakh individuals have shown income over 5 lakhs. Only 5.5 lakh individuals. And only 48,000 people have shown income over 1 crore. Now, my view is that if people pay their income tax, I'm not talking of indirect taxes, income tax, we will be a surplus and a prosperous country if they pay their dues. you could get double or triple what the government is getting today. I don't believe there are only 48,000 who earn a crore of rupees a year. Or 5.5 lakhs people who earn over 5 lakhs a year. See, our people are not honest. We don't want to, and so you have on one extreme dishonest individuals who want to save tax. On the other hand, you have IT officers who are cussed and corrupt and whatever, and harass you.
So they will be coming after everybody now?
Well, they won't come after me or you. I know you don't have...
Who knows? Huh? No, but you don't have to have anything. You don't have to have anything for them to come after you. they can come after you because not only in old days you wrote a nasty article, but these days they can come after you if you wrote a nasty tweet. Or what they see to be a tweet they don't like.
If you ask me, what causes concern to me is the income tax. Lack of clarity of income tax. There is total clarity is missing in our laws. And they can catch you on any item, and they can put you off guard. And even corporate taxes, like they came out with a paper on last 2 months ago on tax to foreign portfolio investors, and which was so negative that entire money could have gone out. Fortunately, there was representation, and the government has put that. It was triple taxation, what they call. They put that on hold in abeyance at the moment. So that clarity in income tax, I think we need much more clarity in the income tax.
Do you want to ask something?
No, I was going to say, it's been once, I think you have to serve now.
I have to serve?
Yeah.
I will serve. Yeah, I have
letting him get away too quickly.
I have written one of his quotes, so I want to read that and ask him a question.
Never write anything because it will be quoted back to you.
He writes so much, it's difficult to keep pace with him, to read all his articles. Okay. In your recent column, you have said, Trump has the most power. Putin can afford to have the most fun, given his total power on Russia. Abe has the biggest problems, given Japan's aging demographies. China's Xi Jinping has the greatest opportunity to be the superpower. The spot supposedly being vacated by an inward-looking America, we talked about it. India has the widest choice of options. From your political lens, tell us why you believe India has the widest option.
Look at the, it's a half-facetious way that a journalist chooses to look at the world from Davos. But the basic thing is that if you look at the issues that each one of these countries has, India has to find opportunities there. Trump has a lot of power because he got America into this negative mood at a time when America is doing quite well. So he may want to build manufacturing in America, but basic realities of labor costs, basic realities of environmental rules, many of the things that you can manufacture in India or China, you cannot manufacture in America. So those realities will hit back soon enough. So you have to see that as an opportunity. Second, Russia. Russia is celebrating and Putin's having fun because Putin thinks that he got Trump elected. And in some ways he did, right? And he thinks Trump is like me, right? Trump's got babes, I've got babes. Trump loves his body, I love my body, right? Trump's I'm a dictator, Trump wants to be a dictator, etc., etc., etc. And his power comes from the fact that in Russia nobody can challenge him. But the fact is, that Trump's interest lies in keeping commodity prices low. Because if Trump is going to build manufacturing in his country, and if he's going to be inward looking, then he wants cheap commodities imported from all over the world, and he is going to build his pipelines, and he's going to pull out more and more of shale gas. Which means commodity prices will be low, and Russia will have a problem. And countries that build their arrogance and economy and their politics on high commodity prices will, in the long run, be weakened. Abe's problems are very simple. Japan is a country today where nobody produces babies anymore. In fact, as we talk, in Japan, the sale of adult diapers has exceeded the sale of baby diapers, right? It's a true statement. I'm not joking with you. So they're just not renewing their population, and they don't like immigration. So they don't know what to do because their growth is coming down because population is coming down. In fact, we met in Davos, a minister from Japan, who has the most unusual portfolio for a minister ever. He is called Minister for Promotion of Reversal of Population Decline. Right? That's his portfolio, because, you know, they have a minister who has to reverse population decline. So that is their problem. China has a great opportunity because America had this supreme slot unquestioned. They were questioned by the Soviet bloc, but since late 80s, 88, 89, when the Soviet Union began to lose in Afghanistan and began to unravel as a result, they've been weakening. So America has that spot. And one of the reasons America has that spot is because of America's moral authority. It's not just the power of their military. It's because they take the right view on so many things which are considered globally virtuous, including climate change, disarmament, treatment of refugees, civil liberties, etc., etc., etc. Global trade, WTO was driven by,
What about India?
Dunkel uncle. No. So I'm saying that, so China sees that opportunity, but China doesn't have the wherewithal for it. China may have the military wherewithal. China will face a problem because manufacturing can shift from China to America for two reasons. One, because Americans would want it back, and second, because Chinese labor costs are also going high. So India's opportunity in America, a lot of the manufacturing that the Americans can't do, we can do. With China, similarly, some of the manufacturing the Chinese may find not worth their while to do, India can do if we bring about basic changes in India. Russia, what Russia makes, Russian commodities are not going to drive its economy too far. What Russia makes, the largest market for that will continue to be India if India plays it right. So that's the opportunity there. Japan has the mortal fear of China. Japan has the mortal fear of China, and with Trump coming into the US, no ally trusts Trump's America. In fact, in his election campaign, he had said that why should we be underwriting the security of Europe and Japan? They should look after their own security. So Japanese are going to be very worried. Japanese are limited by their law and constitution to spend only 1% of their GDP on defense. When 1% of Japan's economy is a lot of money on defense for a country like Japan. Also, given the personal relationship that Mr. Modi has with Abe and many other Japanese, for some reason he gets along with Japanese, including, I believe, the owner of Uniqlo. And I'm hoping that there'll be a Uniqlo store in India soon. So given that, there's a strategic opportunity. Because every country in China's front yard, we are a country in China's backyard, but every country in China's front yard, from Burma until Australia, is scared of China's rise. So that is the big strategy. So there's a manufacturing opportunity, there is a strategic opportunity, there is an exporting opportunity, and there is a moral opportunity, because when America vacates this slot, why should India let China take this? Because Chinese claims for moral authority are all bogus. China is the biggest, carries out the biggest distortion of trade. It is the biggest polluter. It is the biggest liar. It is the biggest violator of human rights, right? China has a terrible record. It's really a case of, I don't know how to translate this, Hindi becomes complicated here, but no so chuhe khake billi haj ko chali, right? So who will trust the Chinese with all their talk about there should be no protectionism? What protectionism our goods face going into China. So I think, given all that, if India one is realistic, so the answer to this is not to build two more assault corps in NEFA to fight China. Northeast, you will not be able to do it, and you don't need to do it. Answer to this is to now work on your economy. There's no point saying at 7% I am the fastest growing. Take it to a level where the world sees this as a booming economy and wants to come here. And the world should think, if I come to India, I can also go out when I feel like, without being messed up with retrospective laws or changing rules, etc. So if you do all that, with Trump changing all these rules, nobody trusting Putin, Chinese having a bad track record, Japanese having fundamental problems, India has right demographics, right manufacturing potential, no commodity dependence, on commodity production, and India has the ability to mine its human talent.
Oil is helping us over the last 2 years, but if oil prices go up, our economy.
Well, I mean, if you look at today's world, I don't think Trump will let oil prices go up.
It's not in Trump's hand, Shekhar.
Well, I mean, he's building these pipelines. He will mine more and more shale, and Canadians can say what they want, but Canadians also want that oil taken out.
Let's shift closer to home. Elections, five elections, five state elections. 17% of India is going to the polls. You normally go around different states when elections are. Do you think, what do you think could be the result? And will demonetization have an impact on the result of
First of all, if I could ever answer the first, I'd be a very rich man. Right? So I can't obviously answer the first. I think each state has a very interesting election. As to your second question, I think everybody says it will be a referendum of demonetization. I don't think so. Because people now make a distinction between a national election and state election. National issues and local issues. National leader and state leader. So if this was an election for Prime Minister, for the national parliament, then demonetization will be a big issue. It will be some bit of an issue, but remember UP also has its election in seven phases. So with each phase, other issues will come up and this will fade. So I don't believe, I think if BJP loses, then opposition would say it was a referendum of demonetization and you lost. If BJP wins, BJP will say it was a demonetization referendum and we won. But I don't think that will be, I don't think a voter who's going to vote, say, in Deoria or in Gonda is going to be thinking about demonetization. I think they are going to be thinking about, has my life gotten better in the past 5 years? If not, who do I blame and who do I trust? And plus loyalties of caste, ethnicity. You know that Muslims will not vote for BJP. You know that... You know that certain castes in Punjab will not vote for Akali Dal. So I think those things are very generic in Indian politics. I think each state will have its own kind of election.
Do you worry about freedom of press? Number of global leaders are also trying to curb the press, freedom of press. What do you think about India and the world? Do you worry, being a journalist all your life, do you worry that how can we continue to having the freedom of press that you've enjoyed over the years? Although some countries you don't have freedom of press.
Well, I worry greatly. I worry greatly also because I've been doing this for so long now that this age it's difficult for me to change and give up my freedom of speech. And I worry greatly because I think globally the rise of the new sort of populist in global politics, of which one extreme example is Trump. The other example is Erdogan at the other end. Just look at the cast of characters in today's world. Trump, Putin, Abe, Xi Jinping, Modi, Erdogan, Netanyahu. And when you have a dull moment, you can find look at Duterte in Philippines, right? It's a world run by alpha males, right? Who always have the last word on everything. And somehow in all their campaigns, they've built an anti-media, anti-journalist, anti-NGO, anti-activist, and in many ways also an anti-judiciary, anti-liberal campaign. So liberals are seen to be having a bad name. Liberals are seen to be people who impede everything. And the idea is ke do teen saal aap, you know, you stay out of our way, let's fix everything, then we'll bring you back. And you find that the use of social media has been done very effectively by these forces. So anytime somebody in public debate disagrees with them, they immediately start throwing muck at that person. And so many of the leaders, I know many leaders in our country who literally employ private armies on social media. If what I'm saying right now is tweeted by somebody, somebody can do it just to check it out. By the time we reach there, there will be lots of compliments to my late mother and my my never-born sisters and etc. 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 So there is this sort of male storm right now, and that's the global mood, and that's why when you have somebody like Theresa May
or Angela Merkel, both women, and some of the others, or even Trudeau, Justin Trudeau, speak out in favor of liberty and liberalism, you feel very grateful. And I think in our country, frankly, threat is not so much from the government. There is a bigger threat from ourselves. You know, Mr. Advani said during the emergency, when asked to bend, India's press crawled. Today, nobody is even asking us to bend. Most of us are already crawling, right? Crawling and praising the government and looking for appreciation from government, which is a very, your favorite channel, Times Now, right? Although our favorite anchor is not there now, it is now running a campaign for remonetization. They forget demonetization. How will they remonetize? They will remonetize the Jains, I don't know. Right, owners of the Times of India Group. How will Times Now remonetize the country? But they are running a campaign now, let's remonetize, because they are hoping that somebody in the PMO will see it, they'll say, shabash, well done. So the threat to our freedoms comes from ourselves. As of now, I would say don't blame the government.
Do you have any reverse return to him?
Yes. Deepak, a question that I've asked always, and it's a question that people have lately been asking film stars. That why don't you rally around victim of injustice in your profession? So when Amir was attacked, other Khans didn't help. Snapdeal withdrew Amir's sponsorship. Suppose Salman, Shah Rukh, Ranveer, they'd all said that we will not take sponsorship of any brand that drops Amir Khan because of what he said. Would not have happened to the rest. But nevertheless, isn't the same true of corporate India?
Can I add to that? The, you know, this question I haven't planned to ask, but leads to this. The recent arrest of bankers because of bad loans. It is a very similar situation to that. So you probably combine that in your answer.
That's a very good point. So why does corporate India immediately go into the trenches and then they whisper, do you know what happened to so-and-so? What injustice. And I will push it with you and I will tell you that people walk up to me, corporate people in parties, and say, can I ask you a question off the record? And I tell them, why should you ask me off the record? I'm a journalist. Why should I be off the record? They say, no, but it's off the record. So it goes on for some time. Finally, I tell them, what you mean is that the fact you asked me this question should be off the record. And they say, yes. And then they say, ye toh economy ko ruin kar raha hai. So itne darpok, why are India's corporates so scared?
I am amazed too why no one speaks in India. I was delighted this morning to read the papers that half a dozen top CEOs of American companies have all spoken against the latest move by President Trump to ban individuals from seven countries, including those who have green cards. And the best statement was, whether you take Tim Cook or anyone, everyone has come out openly. And some people have also said, we have a meeting with President Trump at the end of the week. We are going to raise this issue. This is not acceptable. Trudeau in Canada said diversity is our strength. We are willing to take anyone who wants to come to Canada. So, you know, the American corporates, that's free democracy. They've come up openly against Trump within the first week. And some of the manufacturing companies may have a problem to speak because, you know, Ford and others have been told, we will not allow you to export cars into the United States. But these are all Californian companies, mainly IT, e-commerce companies. They have been very bold, open, Airbnb, Uber, whatever you take. Surprisingly, Indian corporates are extremely quiet. They don't want to talk. Some of them tell me, you can be a spokesman and want me to be in the dock, particularly some of your Delhi wallas. Delhi businessmen.
इसको हम हिंदी पॉलिटिक्स में जैसे दीपक तुम संघर्ष करो हम तुम्हारे साथ हैं.
In fact, some of your colleagues, the business people in Delhi, said we don't even talk on our mobiles with our friend because we don't know, we don't trust that whether our mobiles are tapped. When we meet, we discuss, but we don't talk on mobiles. So somehow there is this fear psychosis in them, and no one wants to talk these days. I'm surprised no one wants to. You know, when UPA government was there, we had a group of people like Keshav Mahendra, Ratan Tata, Ganguly. All of us got together. We wrote open letters in that paper
to Prime Minister Manmohan Singh. He used to call up and says, why are you writing to the press? You have access to me. Tell me what worries you. But there was open conversation. Now some fear is there. People don't want to, they're worried about backlash. They're worried about people getting after them. So I think that is bad for Indian economy. That's bad for Indian business. Indian business must speak. And there are a few people who speak and then they get into trouble. Like Kiran Mazumdar has recently talked about Vijay Mallya, and you see the amount of tweets and the amount of criticism she's got from it. And to answer Shankar's question, I think it's a very bad sign, unless there's absolute proof the government has, which we don't know, that the loans dispersed by IDBI without security, without doing any due diligence, the chairman and some senior executives are beneficiary of that. We do not know that. But if they are not, and
in fact, in the charge sheet, there is no allegation like that.
There's no allegation.
There's no allegation.
So now what will, now the trouble is, you know, our biggest problem in banking is non-performing loans and restructured loans. There are two or three very large, 1 lakh crore plus loans that are being restructured at the moment. I don't think any public sector banker is going to take a decision whether to reduce the interest rate or convert part of the debt into equity or elongate the loan period, the repayment period. I don't think anyone is going to take. In fact, one of the chairmen of the bank said, we will go to bankruptcy court and let the bankruptcy court decide. So what happened in the IDBI case is a dampener. More bankers, public sector bankers would be worried. And it's not good what is happening, because, you know, NPAs and restructured loans is a big, big issue in Indian banking system today. It's more than double digit.
So Deepak, a follow-up question. How come, first of all, am I right to say that most private banks have recovered the money they had loaned to Vijay Mallya? And most PSU banks have failed to do so. And if so, then why?
I think we should keep Vijay Mallya out of it. Because it's blown up, it's too much in the news and all, and I would not like to answer that.
No, okay, let's keep him out.
Don't talk of individual cases.
No. Most private banks have been able to deal with their bad debts much better than PSU banks.
Because private banks agree to a settlement, OT, one-time settlement very quickly, and get on with life. Private banks also are willing to sell their loans to an asset reconstruction company, which we have done. We have recently sold Unitech to ARC, and our bank has sold SR Steel, a number of assets to ARC for 20-30% cash and the rest in security receipts. So decision making is easy. The board supports you. The credit committee supports you. And if the board and the chairman supports the CEO, he's able to take a decision. It's not done arbitrarily. It's not done by one individual. It's done with the backing of the board. This is the problem we have in public sector banks, that unless the government has a nominee on public sector banks, RBI has a nominee on public sector banks, unless they nod, things don't move.
But isn't that what the new bank board is supposed to resolve? It
so the bank board is in progress. The bank board is in progress. In a couple of banks, they have made independent chairman and independent private sector person as CEO in Bank of Baroda. And I meet the Bank of Baroda CEO. He's got great ideas. He's writing off left, right and center. He's taking the support of his board chairman. And he takes his help from him and they go ahead. So I think, but there must be more people willing to join public sector banks as CEOs. And you know the number of vacancies that are there in chairmen and CEOs in public sector banks.
Okay, we started on a high with Deepak about the economy, and we are ending in a little bit of a low when you go to the corporate. So
you said there is need for clarity in income tax law. In fact, as a person who has been in income tax department, I can tell you that the income tax law has been made into a mess, not because of the income tax people, but the non-income tax managers of the department. That is one. Two, are you sure that there is clarity in other laws, particularly company law, or for that matter, the election law? I think unfortunately in this country, the laws are not at all well drafted.
No, I entirely agree. It's not just an income tax act. There is a Companies Act, a number of Securities Act, and there's lot of haziness. You can either go this way or that way. It's
drafting is a big problem. Drafting, inadequate experience of drafting bills.
Yeah. Yes, ma'am. Go ahead.
During the Ram Leela movement, it gave birth to the Aam Aadmi Party. Similarly, we had the Jallikattu ban and the people coming out on in a non-orchestrated, spontaneous manner to start with. Do you think that over a period of time with liberals under threat and whatnot, people will start coming more and more out into the streets for socially relevant or irrelevant issues? And what sort of a threat or image is this giving about India internationally?
I have a question that actually...
Link to that? Link to this?
Yes.
Go ahead.
I was actually going to question...
Closer to the microphone.
Okay. I was actually going to question... it's very easy to sit behind a computer and blog or to write a Twitter feed. Do you think that will make a difference in voices being heard when you say the media are afraid to express their opinions?
When you say the media?
Are afraid to express their opinions.
Media are afraid.
For fear of...
No, so what is the question?
I'm asking you, don't you think bloggers and citizen journalists and people who...
Right. They will fill the void.
Yes, don't you think that is true?
Well, you answer. I think what you saw with Jallikattu or what we saw earlier with Anna movement is also what we saw with Arab Spring in Egypt and Libya and Syria and elsewhere. It is the power of social media. So even in countries or societies where everybody may not be connected by other media, social media is now there. It can be used to rouse people. In fact, Jallikattu was entirely organized on social media. People are just forwarding and re-forwarding and re-forwarding, and that's how this was happening. So I think more and more of this will happen. Second, with more and more people come out and protest, I think if India's economy grows at any rate, which by today's calculation norms is lower than 8% per year, people will come out, because anything below 8% today will be destabilizing. Because that means you are not creating jobs and all these young people are sitting and doing nothing, and they are feeling a loss of self-esteem. So to keep India society moving, this belt, this treadmill has to run at least at the rate of 8. What you said, bloggers, social media, they do fill the gap, because many places where now it's become impossible for the media, for example, to hide a story. Because if one organization hides a story, someone else will publish it, or a journalist will go and write a blog under some fake name, and the story will be out. So now it's become much tougher to hide a story. But at the same time, I don't like citizen journalism, because I say, when you give me citizen doctors, I will give you citizen journalists. Because you need training to be a journalist, and you need intermediation. So at the same time, a lot of folklores and a lot of exaggeration and a lot of mythologies also get put in. So now it's very dangerous. Such and such happened, 10 Indian soldiers are beheaded. Now by the time you check, I mean, most TV channels don't want to check, right? They will go immediately breaking news, and the angry gray mustaches will come, retired generals, and they'll go, you want to use the Pakistan now, right? And everybody will go to war by 8:30. So there is a danger of that also happening. So I think that's the way we are changing right now. And net, it's a good thing that every citizen now has a voice, at least electronically.
We have time for one last question.
Mr. Parekh,
Deepak Bank.
You mentioned during your discussion that one of the objectives of demonetization was to bring about electoral reforms. About a month ago, the Electoral Commission recommended to reduce the limit of 20,000 rupees to 2,000 rupees and nominate the donor. The Prime Minister immediately caught on to this. May I ask you that in the last 1 month, not a word has been mentioned about this. How much do you think the demonetization will succeed if you are not going to have some sort of a reform in this direction? And Mr. Shekhar, you mentioned there were very many options in front of India. May I ask you, what in your opinion, and you believe that the government of India has a firm plan, firm future plan regarding Kashmir and Pakistan? Thank you.
On Pakistan, I think God Almighty will find a solution.
May I request you to give them a round of applause and count.